In recent years, societies in Europe and America have become far more divided. The gap between left and right has become deeper. There's been a rise in populist parties of the far right and far left. The extremes are growing, and the center ground is being abandoned. This is the politics of anger. Why has it happened? And can we create a different kind of politics, the politics of hope? The starting point has to be the fact that for the past 50 years, societies in the West have been dominated by two institutions, the state and the market, politics and economics, the logic of power and the logic of wealth. The state is us in our collective capacity. The market is us as individuals. And the great debate has been about which is more effective in creating a better future. The left tends to favor the state. The right tends to favor the market. But what if this entire way of thinking leaves out something essential? We can see this by asking some simple questions. Suppose there's an organization in which you have total power. One day you decide to share it with 9 others. How much power do you have left? 1/10 of what you began with. Now suppose you have £1,000 and you decide to share that with 9 other people. How much do you have left? 1/10 of what you had before. That's because in the short term, power and wealth are zero-sum games. If I win, you lose. If you win, I lose. In zero-sum games, the more we share, the less we have. That's why politics and economics, the state and the market, are arenas of competition. But now, suppose you decide to share with 9 others not power or wealth, but love or friendship or influence. How much do you have left? Not less. You actually have more, perhaps even 10 times more. That's because love, friendship, and influence are social goods, and social goods are non-zero-sum games. If I win, you also win. With social goods, the more we share, the more we have. That's because social goods are not about competition, they're about cooperation. We find social goods not in the state or the market, but in families, communities, neighborhoods, voluntary groups, and the like. And they're essential to any human group because we are social animals. And what gives us our strength is our ability to cooperate as well as compete. A world with competition but no cooperation would be lonely, nasty, and fraught with conflict. To understand the difference between these two kinds of interactions, we need to make a distinction between two ideas that sound similar but are actually not, namely a contract and a covenant. In a contract, two or more individuals, each pursuing their own interest, come together to make an exchange for mutual benefit. So, for instance, when I buy something from you, you give me the item or the service I want, and in exchange, I pay you. That's a commercial contract, and that's what makes the market economy. Or, I pay taxes in return for the services provided by the government. That's the social contract, and it creates the state. But a covenant is different. The simplest example of a covenant is a marriage. Two people, each respecting the dignity and integrity of the other, come together in a bond of loyalty and trust to share their lives by pledging their faithfulness to one another to do together what neither can achieve alone. A contract is about interests, but a covenant is about identity. It's about you and me coming together to form an us. The difference is huge. The social contract creates a state, but the social covenant creates a society. A society is about all the things that bind us together as a collective group bound to the common good without transactions of wealth or power. In a society, we help our neighbors not because they pay us to or because the state forces us to, but simply because they're part of the collective us. We can now see why politics in the West have become more divided, abrasive, and extreme. For at least a half century, we've focused on the market and the state, while ignoring the third dimension called society. We've focused on contracts while ignoring covenants. Our sense of competition is strong, but our bonds of cooperation have grown weak as families and communities have fractured. This can work for a while, during times of economic growth and peace, when most people feel that life is getting better for them and their children. But when they feel that life is getting tougher for them and their children, it all begins to go wrong. People see around them the zero-sum games of the market and the state. A few gain, many lose, and everything is about competition and self-interest. That's when you get the politics of anger. The only real antidote is to renew the social covenant that says we are bound by bonds that go deeper than self-interest. We share an identity and a fate, and we're collectively responsible for the common good. We need to remember that societies are strong when they care for the weak. They are rich when they care for the poor, and they are invulnerable when they care for the vulnerable. When we restore the social covenant, we defeat the politics of anger and recreate the politics of hope.